Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman, and it's another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Emily Lawton. She's a software engineer on Cosmos DB. How are you?
I'm great, Scott. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's
cool. Happy to be here.
So I've used Cosmos DB with some Mongo apps where I literally just swapped the URL out for the connection string, and it totally worked.
Yeah.
And then I just said to myself, wow, that's amazing. It's 100% compatible. Is that true? Is it 100% compatible?
So that's why I'm thrilled to be here today, because we have a number of new features that we've been working on the past couple months and even the past couple weeks that will enable Mongo customers to migrate much more complex and powerful applications to Cosmos. Mm. And we have, with these updates, we can much more confidently say, you know, we do support all of the most sought-after Mongo features and are fully invested in really making sure that we have any developers coming over from Mongo that we're there to support them with the proper tools and resources to succeed in Cosmos.
Now there's like imagine a pie chart of all the features that Cosmos could have, right?
Yeah, there's
and
a lot.
There's a lot of stuff, right? And you're doing like some percentage of them that's, you know, less than 100%, but
yes,
still 80%, 90%, some big number because it works really well. When a Cosmos application that's a client talks to, excuse me, when a Mongo application talks to Cosmos and it doesn't support that, does it just go, or like, how does it say, I don't know how to do that?
Yeah, we're constantly working on improving this experience. And like just the other day, we're working on updating. So we have a lot of features in private preview, so you need to email us. So make sure we're giving much more gentle error messages to let them know that, you know, we do support this, we're working on it. And yeah.
So if you're an active user of this and you really want to engage with the Cosmos team, then you could talk to you, be in private previews, and then when you start to use a new feature, it could say, oh, we were totally working on this feature. Don't freak out.
Yeah, and all the things we support are completely based on, oh, we heard this customer yesterday that really needs this feature, and we run in, we're fighting fires every day to make sure we help them out.
What are some new things that are happening in Cosmos space?
So the three things I'm going to discuss today are some tips and tricks for successful migration, support for the aggregation pipeline, and support for unique indexes.
An aggregation pipeline is a feature that people who use Mongo like really like, and it's one of the most asked for ones.
Yeah. So one of the major pain points that our Mongo customers hit when moving over to Cosmos is simply just migrating their data. So we have a few updates to help squash any errors that they're running into there. When customers have a lot of data, we generally ask them to go to the MongoDB Download Center, get Mongo import. And a lot of times when they run this, they'll hit throttling errors. And this is largely because collections, when created in Cosmos, are defined with an 1,000 provisioned RUs. And oftentimes this isn't enough for a large data migration. So one of the first tips we want our customers to know is that it's best if you go into the Azure portal and pre-create the collections you want to import data into and bump up the RUs during the migration. Then once migration is complete, go down and decrease the RUs. So this is one way to help get past these issues. Another thing is that we've added two new options to the Mongo import command. One is number of insertion workers and batch size. And I've included a link here which goes through a very detailed process of how to compute these values. And when computed correctly, you won't see any throttling and your migration will be much smoother and you'll get up and going with Cosmos at a much quicker rate.
Do you have a rule of thumb or a general sense? Because you said large.
Yeah.
And like I did a migration, but I don't know what I'm doing. And I used an application called Mongo Chef Core. And I basically opened up two connections, one to Cosmos and one to Mongo, and I drag and dropped. I don't know if that was bad.
Yeah, no, so it's a lot of experimentation to get the right parameters here to make sure your migration is smooth. But I swear by this link, if you go to it, it goes through details.
That is
how
the Bible for Cosmos and MongoDB migrate.
Yes.
Cool. So if I follow those, then I will have a good experience.
You will.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
The next update that I'd love to talk about today is our support for the aggregation pipeline.
So
we know in today's data-driven age, it's incredibly important to give tools to our developers to make sure that they can quickly gain insights into their data. So Mongo developed this framework called Aggregation Pipeline, which is essentially an alternative to MapReduce. But it's much more lightweight, it's easier to get ramped up on, and is used whenever the complexity of MapReduce is unwarranted. So I'll go through some demonstrations of the things that you can do with aggregation pipeline.
And
this is something our team has been working on for
And out of curiosity, what would I have seen if I tried to do these things before? Would Mongo have given, would Cosmos have said an error?
It would have said, yeah, we don't support this.
Okay, but it returns an error that indicates a lack of support.
Yes, yes.
Not like a general 500 error.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, that's cool.
So one of my favorite hobbies is running. So let's connect to my account. And I've loaded up the results of the 2017 Boston Marathon here.
Mm-hmm. And you're in the Mongo shell. You're just in the Windows command line. Windows Mongo shell. Is it bad that the shell and the server versions don't match? Does that mean anything?
In this scenario, it's not a problem. There are some new operators that were added in 3.4.
Okay. So not a big deal.
Yeah. So let's first just do.
Did you really do the Boston Marathon?
I did not run it.
Okay.
I wish. So an aggregate command takes in an array of stages.
Okay.
So let's just experiment with the match stage first. So the match is essentially just a SQL WHERE clause. So let's say we want to find all the data we have about the runner Galen Rupp. Galen was an American professional long distance runner. He runs for the Nike Oregon Project.
Okay.
He's a role model of mine.
That's cool.
So let's see.
From Oregon. I grew up down the street from Nike.
Nice.
If I bump into him while I'm walking, then I will say hi.
So. Okay. This is what a match query looks like. And so we see this is the document that's associated with Galen Rupp. We see he's from Portland.
Yeah.
His official time was 2 hours and 9 minutes. And his overall place was second in
that's
the Boston Marathon.
That's 26 miles?
Which is, yes.
That's like 12 miles
26.2, yeah.
I don't think I can ride my bike that fast.
So he had a very impressive finish.
Mm-hmm.
So this type of query isn't that interesting. So let's do some more interesting types of
out of curiosity, is that, and that, that you used an aggregate query, but there's ways that I could have queried for that without using the aggregate
clause. Yes, you could also
do, because that was aware.
Yeah, you could also do a simple find query, specify the filter that you want to specify. And I should note that you always want to, when using the aggregation pipeline, this is just a tip for once you get started in using this, you want to do the match stage generally as early on as the pipeline as you can to filter out and make sure you have fewer documents as you go through the pipeline.
I see. So it is a pipeline and like a sales pipeline. It's like the smaller it gets, the less data you have to deal with farther down in the pipeline.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, cool.
So let's find all the runners that actually ran faster than 3 hours. So here we'll use a conditional operator. Less than, still the same type of match query.
Right.
And now we'll get a long list of all the runners that ran faster than 3 hours.
That's
this is
fast.
Not that interesting because it's hard to kind of visualize or scroll through these results.
Sure.
But let's say we actually, now let's do something a little bit more interesting. Let's say we want to group the runners by their country and see what the average place of the runners in those groups is.
Okay.
So here we add the group stage, and all group stages require an underscore ID field, which is what you're grouping the documents by.
Now, if I understand your tip from before, if I had flipped this around and did the group first and then the match, it's kind of silly because I'd be taking everyone, grouping them by country, and then chopping them up by time?
Yes, yes. So let's go ahead and make sure I copied that one.
Feels like PowerShell for data.
Kind of.
Cool.
And again, we get a list of an array of all of the countries that had runners that ran faster than 3 hours.
And is it sorted?
This is not sorted. I have another query that will getting
Thank
ahead
you.
Of us.
No, pardon me.
So the next one, let's find the number of runners in each of those groups, which is be a little bit more interesting.
Okay.
And here we can specify within the group stage an accumulator, and we're going to use the sum accumulator and sum up one for each runner in that each group.
Sum up one. Okay, so then it'll be the count of the number of people.
Yes.
Under 3 hours per country.
Yes.
Okay, so you're doing a projection at this point now. You're making a new kind of object.
Yeah, we created a new field. So here we see again. It's kind of hard to understand.
See Austria had 8. That's good. Egypt had 1.
Yeah, and
cool.
Then the next thing we'll do is let's find the average, like we wanted to, like I said earlier, find the average overall place of each of the countries.
Mm-hmm.
Let's order them in a way such that we can actually see which country had the fastest average time.
Oh, that's a good point. Otherwise, I'm just scrolling around. Okay.
And we're going to sort by average place, and we pass a negative 1 because we want to sort in descending order.
Negative 1 is descending, okay.
And
hey,
here we
Zimbabwe.
See Zimbabwe actually had the fastest or the lowest average place, which was 14, but they only had 1 runner.
Okay.
So last query we'll do is let's see actually who had the most runners that finished less than 3 hours.
My wife is from Zimbabwe. Okay, cool.
And here we see the United States had the most runners that finished faster than 3 hours.
Are we last, though?
We are not.
We sorted last.
You can also find that. Oh, well, no, I sorted in ascending order this time.
Oh, okay, good.
So you can see that we had over 1,000 runners, which is over 10 times more than the next country had.
Which makes sense since it was in Boston.
It was in Boston.
That is pretty slick. And it's coming back so fast, though.
Yeah, so this data set had, I think, 25,000 documents, so it's not huge. But we're continually working on making sure this pipeline is scalable. Because when you pair it with all of the features that you get that come with Cosmos, like auto-scaling with provisioned RUs, auto-sharding, and automatic indexing, it makes for a really synergistic effect and a great experience.
Yeah, I mean, you're getting the feeling of your favorite database, your Mongo experience, and the familiarity that I can see that you have with the syntax, but it's a global database. It's geo-replicated. It's the best of both worlds.
Yep, exactly.
That's pretty slick.
So it's super fun to work on. And then quickly, one other update that I'd like to discuss is support for unique indexes. This was another thing that our customers were badgering us for, so we went ahead and delivered. And as the name suggests, unique indexes just ensures that the fields that you specify the unique index on cannot have duplicate values.
Interesting. That feels like it blurs the line a little bit between a document database where you just throw anything into it and in a relational database where the ID matters.
Yeah. You can imagine if you had some sort of a collection that was containing like account data that had a tax ID field or something. You'd want to make sure that field is unique so that you don't have multiple accounts with the same tax ID.
Okay.
And so quickly, here's the syntax for how you create a unique index. You can go ahead and once you have this feature enabled on your account, you can create it on any field. For instance, this is the user ID field, and then you just specify the unique attribute to true.
That seems pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
What if it already has a bunch of data in it?
So one thing to note is that you cannot actually create a unique index on a field that already does not follow the constraint.
Oh, okay, I see.
Yeah.
So it's only at the time of creation that you do that, is on
a modified. Well, you can still actually create it once the field has already been there, but we'll just go through and make sure that you don't already have duplicate values there, because you can't do that.
And then if you did, you would deal with that?
We'll still work on a better experience.
Okay. But it sounds like pretty straightforward. I could just make a temporary collection, spin through it, project over to it, and dedupe.
Yes. Yeah.
Very cool. And is this all right now, happening now, or do I have to sign up for a preview? How do I get involved?
So these two features are currently in private preview, which means I've included the link that you can email us at, and we will enable this. We're very quick about enabling it on accounts. And by the end of the year, this will be in public preview, and you can actually go into the Azure portal and in a self-serve fashion enable it on your accounts and take advantage of all these new updates.
And you were saying that you are doing all of these features in this order because people are asking for them. And if they email you, like real people are on the other end of that email, and a team is excited to hear about what you're using with Mongo and Cosmos and how to make it better.
Yes.
Very cool. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you for having me.
All right. I am learning all about MongoDB and Azure Cosmos DB here on Azure Friday.